believe we're going to be on Mars in 20 to 30 years. I say clearly, yes, yes, and again, yes.
I firmly believe the first human to walk on Mars is already born. I might be just watching this show as a, you know, young teenager. I hope so. So if you're out there, please stay in the STEM field, study. We are building your rocket right now, so
go for it.
Go for it. Go for it. Go for it.
Oh, fuck!
Dominic, you have 12 minutes left of oxygen.
So, didn't go quite to plan. The ship's gone, oxygen's running out, and there's something wrong with the computer because it keeps randomly playing bits of old archive footage.
But I actually need them because otherwise the video won't work, so...
Getting to Mars was never going to be easy though. Space travel is ruddy risky. For example, between 1981 and 2011, NASA's space shuttle program carried 833 passengers and 14 of those lost their lives. That's a fatality rate of 1.6%, which doesn't sound much, but it's actually more dangerous than driving your car and a bit riskier than climbing Mount Everest. On the bright side, I'm officially the furthest from Earth that any human has ever been before. Yay! Now, making rockets that are capable of taking us to Mars without blowing up is one thing, but it's all the hazards that we face along the way that are the biggest challenge, not to mention the ones if we actually get there. Contradictory to its name, space is not just space. It's teeming with high-energy particles blasted out by the sun and other stars, and away from the cozy magnetosphere of Earth, you'll be exposed to them. Unshielded astronauts, like me, can expect to receive an extra 0.3 sieverts of radiation, equivalent to 24 CAT scans. That's 15 times the annual radiation limit for workers at nuclear power plants. Oh, and one sievert is associated with a 5.5% increase in cancer risk. 8 sieverts can kill, so 0.3... I should be okay. Solar flares though, now that's what you want to watch out for. Unpredictable giant solar eruptions that send dense clouds of electrons and protons flying through space, playing havoc with your body and electronic equipment. Solar flares are... What the... Bloody computer...
As radiation is one of the challenges we're going to face, that means that we might have solar particle eruptions in the sun. The sun is a violent star. Now, like for any journey, you would have to prepare for that, for going at a time where you don't expect a lot of those happen. We know there are cycles in the solar activity, so you would go to a time where the probability for a solar storm is as low as possible. However, if it still hits you, then you want to have some shielding with you.
It turns out that one of the best materials for radiation shielding is water. It's got a lot of hydrogen in it, which really helps to absorb that radiation nice and quickly. So a really clever design would be to have all of your water tanks, which you'll need to take with you anyway, wrapped around a particular portion of the spaceship. We'd call this the storm shelter. And when your space weather report comes in, that a solar flare has gone off and it's directed towards you and your spaceship, you'd have to clamber into this small cupboard-sized area for 6, maybe even up to 12 hours to protect yourself from that radiation pulse. Another option would be to create an artificial magnetic field around your spacecraft, so literally a deflector shield. The problem with that though is you're now relying a lot of technology and complicated electronics, so that's probably less reliable than just surrounding your storm shelter with water tanks. And of course as well, having some kind of superconducting magnet to create this magnetic field around you is going to be very demanding on electricity, and that's one of the main things you're limited on for a spaceship, particularly if you're relying on solar panels to generate that electricity for you.
That's basically what I was going to say.
Dominic, you have 8 minutes left
yes,
of oxygen.
Thank you. Well, at least I won't have to deal with living on Mars. Mars doesn't have an ozone layer and not much of a magnetic field either, so you're still going to be pelted by cosmic rays and UV rays from the sun at far higher doses than on Earth. That means a lot of time indoors, whether that be in shelters that you've taken or inside one of Mars's giant lava caves. And I prefer the fresh air, which brings me to the next problem. There is none. Air, that is. The atmosphere on Mars isn't breathable. We can use oxygen tanks on the journey, but if we want people to be there for any considerable amount of time, then we need to think of other ways, like terraforming.
Terraforming is the idea of converting the environment on Mars to be much more Earth-like. So this would mean pumping back up the atmosphere on Mars, so it's much thicker and there's much greater greenhouse effect to keep the surface much warmer and to allow liquid water to flow on the surface and for the Martian astronauts to be able to grow their own crops. The sort of processes we'd need to terraform Mars would include things like perhaps detonating nuclear bombs over its polar ice caps, trying to return a lot of that dry ice, that carbon dioxide ice, back into the atmosphere, and trying to release a lot of the permafrost, a lot of the frozen water from underground to once again flow as liquid. But this is a really difficult thing to try to do. It'll take an inordinate amount of money and take a very long time. So we're talking centuries into the future.
We can at least harvest oxygen on Mars though. The atmosphere is 96% carbon dioxide, which can be split to extract breathable oxygen, or we can extract oxygen from any water that we find there. The separation process might take longer than it does here on Earth though, as it relies on gravity, and Mars's gravitational pull is only about 38% of Earth's. And yeah, gravity, that's something else that might get you down. Human bodies are optimized to function in Earth's gravity. In low gravity, they just don't work as well.
We've been looking into the risks of zero gravity for years and years since the beginning of spaceflight. And we have experience from missions that took more than a year, actually. We know there's a few short-term effects like muscular atrophy, you change your immune system a little bit, you have fluid shifts. There are a few things that are inconvenient, like, you know, you feel your head is swelling a little bit and your legs are getting smaller. So you realize a few things are more relevant than zero G, like the strength of your arms, and you don't need your legs. A perfect cosmonaut would be six arms, no legs, and a big head.
So the sort of things you'll need to do while on your way to Mars are to essentially spend a lot of time in the space gym, trying to keep your muscles, and particularly your heart, nice and strong. And another idea, a technological solution, would be to generate artificial gravity. You could have a big rotating section of your spacecraft that would create artificial gravity through the centrifugal force. You would walk around the inside of this ring, feeling an Earth normal gravity.
And the physical effects don't end there either. Some astronauts have reported problems with their eyesight too, with one astronaut on the ISS going from 20/20 vision to 20/100 after just 6 months. For context, 20/20 vision is the baseline for human vision. You see, you know that chart in the opticians? Well, that's called the Snellen chart. If you can read this line of text from 20 feet away, then you have 20/20 vision. Having 20/100 vision means that you can read the same line of text as well as someone with 20/20 vision, but if that person was standing 100 feet away. So, not very well at all.
Dominic, you have 4 minutes left of oxygen.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I'm well aware that I'm gonna die soon. Even things like sleeping can be a struggle in low gravity, and many astronauts suffer from insomnia aboard the ISS. Being a bit grumpy for a cramped 6 month mission to Mars is one thing, but sleep deprivation also greatly impairs decision making and could pose a real risk on a long haul mission to Mars. Exercise has been used as the main strategy to overcome many of these problems, but it has its limits, with astronauts having to go through recovery programs on their return to Earth. So scientists are still working on the solutions, and in some pretty unusual places too, like bears.
To protect human astronauts in microgravity, we could look to what solutions Mother Nature has found to similar problems here on Earth. When black bears hibernate, they'd face a lot of the same problems as a human astronaut in space. They're asleep, they're not doing anything for months on end, and so their muscles would waste away, or their bones would decrease. And so what the bear does to solve those problems is it's able to control the levels of proteins and enzymes in its blood that block that bone wasting process.
Researchers found that levels of certain proteins, which reduce the quantity of bone minerals being broken down into the bear's blood, increased 15-fold during their hibernation, And yet, enzymes that contribute to bone regeneration dropped significantly, showing that bears are able to maintain their skeletal structure and strength by suppressing bone loss during hibernation, rather than generating new bone material. Research is ongoing, but it's definitely something to bear in mind. And speaking of mind, well, truth is, I kind of lost mine.
Ground control to Major Dom.
I may or may not be responsible for the ship exploding into a billion pieces. Taking a trip to Mars sounds exciting, and it is, at first. But after months of boggle and reading Harry Potter 12 for the 8th time aboard a tiny ship, sleeping, eating, working and defecating within a few feet of your crewmates, well, it's a bit of a strain on the old noggin.
If there were to be some kind of psychological problem today on the International Space Station, the solution is relatively straightforward. You might be able to restrain the astronaut and then simply come back down to Earth in a matter of hours. But on a long duration mission to Mars, you simply don't have that as an option. You are months and months away from any help.
We have procedures in place if somebody goes crazy. We had situations in all the years of space flight where people develop psychiatric disorders, for instance. So we have ways how to deal with, schizophrenic episodes in space. And for that, we have provisions. I mean, that could mean just sedating people. That could even mean strapping down people. I don't think we're going to have to go all the way and space somebody. People have been talking about what if people don't see the Earth anymore because it's just become a little star-like object in the sky. This Earth out of sight phenomenon that people say, well, maybe they get crazy. I don't think so. You can be in a ship without seeing the shoreline and be still very happy. I claim that the human psyche is not the weakest link in the chain. In fact, it's a link which is much stronger than we think.
Dominic, you have 30 seconds left of oxygen.
Well, I guess that's it. But what do you think? Will we ever get people to Mars, and should we? Is there even any point? I like to think so. I suppose I wouldn't be in this pickle right now if I didn't. And so, to all those scientists, engineers, and intrepid explorers, I salute you.
Oxygen depleted. I should have told him that I loved him.
Dinner's ready!
Coming!
Oh, and I've been Dom, and you've been watching everything.
It's getting cold!
There are many reasons why we should go to Mars. I mean, there are some scientific reasons like what about finding out if we're alone in the universe? There are some incredible answers out there. For me as a scientist, that's a primary drive. But the very reason why we should go is because it's there. It's the most justified, the most human, the most honest reason, and that is we have as a species the drive to explore. And that's a driving force and a success reason for us as a society. So in a history book, 500 years from now, when we look back to our century, it will be remembered not because of an economic crisis, not because the wars here or there, but it's the time when we start to leave Earth orbit and go beyond. To be in that century where we're actually building the ships for going there, that's a privilege.
Hello, and thank you for getting this far in the video. That means you've watched the whole thing, and that's amazing because it's the longest video that I've ever made. So thank you, big thumbs up. Also a massive thank you to my contributors, Gernot Grömer from the Austrian Space Forum and Lewis Dartnell from the University of Westminster. They were a massive help, really interesting guys, and they know a lot about space. So thank you very much, guys. I also just want to take this opportunity to remind you about my Patreon. And if you're not sure what Patreon is, it's basically this website where you can help all your YouTube creators by donating like tiny little bits, like a dollar a month or a dollar a video or more if you can do it. Any help would be much appreciated because these videos are really hard to make and they take ages. This one, for example, I think took, I roughly added up the hours of rendering time, and I'd say it was at least 72 hours of rendering time. So head over to Patreon, check it out, give me a dollar, maybe. And that's it. If you like this video, let me know in the comments. Hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, hit the bell so you know when I release a video, because it isn't that often. So it's good to know when that happens. Take care. Bye.